Hi, and welcome to my alternative reality. This week we examine the world of alternative comedy and also descend upon a women's festival. Stay tuned and enjoy the trip. With the Melbourne International Comedy Festival on, our reporter Liam checked out two of the more different comedians and got them to explain their special brand of humour.
Hi, I'm Liam from Maha's Alternative Reality. Tonight, I'll be interviewing a cult comedian from the UK, Andrew O'Neill, and Sydney comedian Anthony Salome from Fat Pizza, Swift and Shift, and all different kinds of stuff. Stay tuned, hope you enjoy. Arizona, sex on the rock,
time on the red, and we bled. I'm here with Andrew O'Neill, a cult comedian from UK. How are you going?
I'm all right, thank you very much. I'm very hungry.
Hungry, yeah.
Because I didn't have much in the way of breakfast. I bought some cereal that I was quite disappointed by, so I had enough of it to stop me actually falling down on the way here, but not enough to completely fill me up.
I know I wouldn't have done the interview if I hadn't eaten. I wouldn't refuse to come.
Well, you know, people have different priorities in life, you know.
Clearly my spirit. How would you describe what you do, like a cult comedian transvestite? What would you say in the mind of that?
Funny.
Knock, knock. A poltergeist! You see what I mean? Now, right, now those of you that didn't laugh at that joke, right, it's going to be a rocky road ahead, because that's... I consider that to be one of my finest. Now,
I try and make the sort of comedy I would most like to see myself.
Yeah.
So, regardless of any kind of, I don't know, commercial sort of motivations, I've always been a massive comedy fan.
Yeah.
And I've always liked weird comedy, intelligent comedy. I've always liked loads of different styles, so I just try to find a synthesis of the different types of comedy I wanted to make. So, the various labels that people can put on it, because I am, in my own way, I suppose, a weirdo, but also, you know, in several different ways. So, like, I'm a metalhead, I'm a vegan, I'm a transvestite. Off duty today, it's my day off. So, it means that people, particularly mainstream people, looking from the outside will sort of go, oh wow, he's all these sort of different things. But from my point of view, I'm just me trying to be as funny as I can possibly be.
I will be drinking throughout my show. It's not very professional of me, I'm aware of that, but I do have a genetic condition whereby my body doesn't produce its own booze. So I'm forced to take a supplement. So! Fundamentalist Muslim lady ninja, how do you know which are your work clothes?
Would you say being a transvestite has ever hindered anyone coming to your show?
Yeah, probably.
Yeah.
If I'm wearing makeup on a flyer, there'll be people, you know, because I'm always at pains to sort of state that I'm not a drag act, it's not a cabaret show. I'm fairly blokey transvestite. You know, it's a part of who I am, and I think cross-dressing and particularly in a very visible way is a political act. And you walk around the city on a weeknight around the CBD, the people who look at me with most disdain are the ones in the suits and ties. They're the ones who've most tailored their appearance to maximum acceptance. Yeah. And there's, you know, I can't help but think there's an element of jealousy in that. There's an element of looking at the freedom that I've got to wear whatever the fuck I want on any given day. And they absolutely can't do that. Yeah, they're literally stuffed into a suit and tie.
So who are some of your comedy influences?
Monty Python's the biggest one.
Yep.
I genuinely think Monty Python is the high point of human civilization. Bill Hicks, Bill Bailey, Harry Hill, Eddie Izzard, Simon Munnery, who's here at the festival, Stuart Lee. Anyone who either stylistically or in terms of their content is interesting and kind of challenging. I've always liked comedy where I'm laughing and not knowing why. And that's the thing I most try and do in my stand-up.
Shrilly ba 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 do ba ba do ba boodly ba 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 400 yards, turn left. Shrilly ba ba, shrilly ba ba, shrilly ba ba, shrilly ba ba, take the roundabout, third exit. Shoot the ba ba do ba, turn around where possible. Scat now.
And I don't do, like, corporate gigs, which, for the vast majority of comics, that's where they make most of their money. But for me, going in front of a corporation, just doesn't sit right. So there's that, but then also, that, you know, from the other point of view is, I think, there's an honesty if you have that approach, and people who approach stand-up in the same way as I do, there's something more personal about it, and there's something more, it's always going to be a little bit more interesting, I think, because I have the point of view of someone who's, every band I've ever done, there's no possible way we can make money from it. Yeah. So we don't make any decisions based on that. With my stand-up, there's never a point in my head where I'm thinking, how commercial would this be? How successful will this be? If I think it's funny, it goes in the show. And usually, it means the audience think it's funny anyway. And in actual fact, I think you're more likely to get a fan base that reacts to you in a way. I suppose it's like, you know, this is our guy. You know, my fans are really loyal because I'm doing something that they can't find elsewhere. Whereas most of the acts you'll see on telly, and you know, a lot of them are my mates, and a lot of them I think are very funny, they're kind of comparable to something else. So it's like kind of pop music versus underground music, you know? When you see a band you really love, and you know, that's an underground band, you support them, you buy their stuff, you follow them, you find out where they're playing next. If you consume music through the radio, you don't have the same relationship with it.
Thanks a lot for that. That's a pleasure. Really appreciate you coming on. We're here with Anthony Salome. Some people may recognise him from Fat Pizza, Swift and Shift. First, I want to say thank you for coming along.
No worries, man. Thanks for having me.
No problem. You've just released the DVD, Is This Thing On?
Yes, that's
very
great.
Very funny DVD. Everyone should go out and buy a copy from JB
Hi-Fi.
Two copies. Just buy it and sell them to everyone.
Why not? Well, give one to your mum. She'll probably bash you for it.
So how long have you been doing comedy? What got you into it?
Stand-up comedy, probably about 6 years now. I started out in theatre acting, and I've always had a love and a passion for stand-up comedy. You know, growing up, you know, watching Eddie Murphy, Raw and Delirious, like, you know, I used to see that and think, man, like, it'd be unbelievable to do that. I never really thought about doing it, but I was doing a stage production. And the director was Tahir Bilgic, another great Australian comedian. And I just said to him, I go, Tahir, like, I've got a few jokes I've written down, just tell me what you think, you know? And he said to me, I've got a gig on in 2 weeks, do 5 minutes before me. And, you know, it just started from there, man. The rest is history, you know, went really well. And, you know, it's, I love it.
Jamie Oliver's Kitchen, I love this show. Yeah, I love it. He's like a chef on coke. He's like, wait, you got to? Yeah, I got to mix it up a little bit. Just mix it up a little bit. Add a bit of salt, yeah. Add a bit of salt, taste it. Need to leave a bit more salt, yeah. A little bit more salt, taste it. Wicked! Now we got to jump over here, yeah. We got the meat, yeah. We're going to smell all the flavours, yeah. Just smell all the flavours. I'm like, man, imagine this guy in the bedroom. What you got to do? You got to spread the legs, yeah. Just spread the legs. Start playing, we get a nice moist and wet, yeah. Smell all the flavours, yeah. Just smell all the flavours. Don't be shy, yeah. Put a 3 in there, she's loving it. Put 2. Wicked!
So what got you into acting then? Like doing Swift and Shift, Pizza?
Well, you know, I started with stage. And because Tahir was the director of one of my shows, Paul Fenwick, the director and creator of Pizza and Swift and Shift and Cow's Eyes and all those shows, he came along to a gig and saw me, and you know, I guess he saw something that he liked, that he could use, I guess. And yeah, it was great, man. It was a great experience, you know, doing those shows, and it was good fun.
What influence would you say being Lebanese has had in your comedy career?
Yeah, pretty big, man. Like, I think so. You know, when I first started, I think when you first start comedy, your first 10 minutes is kind of everything that you relate to at that time, you know. Well, my first kind of jokes was, you know, well, it wasn't all ethnic stuff, but it did have to, to do with, you know, my background and you know, even still today, you know, I still talk about, you know, how my parents are and in my stand-up and how it was going back to Lebanon. And I mean, you know, some people might try and, you know, pigeonhole, like they might try and cage you in as a certain kind of comedian, like an ethnic comedian or this kind of comedian, which I think is wrong. You know, it's I think if someone has a certain something about them, like a little bag of tricks or maybe something that other comedian doesn't have, I don't think they should be labelled as a certain stereotype, you know. But it's had a great influence, and it will continue to have a great influence, because, you know, it's part of my life. My culture is, you know, I experience it every day. I live it every day, because I still live at home with my parents. But yeah, man, it's a great thing. It's a beautiful thing, man. And I think anyone that looks down on it is pretty stupid.
Yeah. So just for fun, have you decided to like go into JB, pick up your DVD and just walk out and be like, nah, I'm not paying for it. Just, it's me.
No, I haven't.
I reckon you should just see what happens. It would be very entertaining. I do it at Macca's, I'm like, I'm the hamburger and just walk out. Goes great.
But
thanks a lot for coming along.
Thank you for having me, man.
Everyone should seriously buy this. One of the best DVDs I've seen.
It really is.
And if anyone wants to know about your gigs, go to anthonysalome.com.
Anthonysalome.com.
Follow him on Twitter,
Facebook, YouTube, Shitter. No, sorry. No. Thanks, guys. Am I allowed to say shit?
Yeah, no? Yeah, we can say what we want.
Fucking shit.
Actually, not that.
Oh, sorry.
No,
Beep that out.
I've interviewed some alternative comedians. I hope you've enjoyed looking into their world. Thanks for watching Maha's Alternative Reality. I've been Liam.
Fuck. Yeah, you don't want none of this. Oh yeah, I'm so great. So great, great. Ah! Oh no! No! Oh, I can see the top of its head. Oh! Ah! Oh! What the hell is that? Oh! Ah! Ah! Oh! Close the door! Close the door! Close the door! Where's my chair? Oh! Okay. All right. I got my chair. Oh! Protect me, chair. Oh, protect me. Oh, protect me. Oh, protect me. Ah, why did I have a flashlight? Oh, God, oh, God, oh, God. Get away, get away. Ah, yeah, take that. Oh, so badass. Oh.
A reporter, Amber, recently engaged in some women's business at the Seven Sisters Women's Festival. Continue watching if you want to learn the secrets of the sisterhood.
Out here today at Kiala just outside Shepparton for the Seven Sisters Festival. The Seven Sisters Festival is an all-woman event and it's all about getting back to your sacred femininity. So we've got an all-woman crew today and we're going to have to wave goodbye to our dear driver, Neil. Let's head in. So we're here chatting with Lauren, and Lauren is one of the co-organisers and founders of the Seven Sisters Festival. How did it all come about, Lauren?
it's a very interesting story. I suppose last year I'd been doing a lot of women's work myself, and I'd really developed a kind of deep appreciation for the work that I'd been taught. And I was shocked as well that how little information is actually out there to relate to women's health, women's spirituality, and just general well-being. And it made me recognise as well why all these ancient cultures would have women's circles where they would have the elder women and the younger women sharing together, sharing stories, sharing wisdom. And there's a sense of sisterhood and community that in our modern day cultures I find is really lacking. I just had these whisperings that, this should come about, this should happen. And the name Seven Sisters Festival, celebrating the sacred feminine, came, and it just wouldn't leave me alone. The significance and what it related to, I found out it actually relates to the Pleiades constellation, and that this constellation can be seen on all seven continents, and that there's an Aboriginal Dreamtime story relating to the Seven Sisters, and every culture, in fact, has a story relating to the Seven Sisters.
Wow, really?
Yeah, it was absolutely, yeah, quite amazing. And I started to share the idea with a few women, and they loved it, and they were eager, and I realized that there's such a hunger amongst, yeah, the mainstream community as well, to have a little bit more information, to have that sisterhood, and to have that community and that connection.
Stacia is a holistic healer, and she took a large part in organising the opening ceremony here at Seven Sisters. Stacia, can you tell me a little bit about that process?
Sure. So it's part of the work I do. I'm really passionate about ritual and ceremony, holding community together, and that we need to bring that back into our community gatherings. Lauren told me about the story of the Seven Sisters and how at the time she chose the name, she wasn't aware that there were stories throughout the seven continents. Indigenous tribal stories, many different indigenous versions in Australia that talk about the Seven Sisters and that they are formed, they form the star constellation of Pleiades. But the story is, when I read through them to get a sense of how we'll journey through the opening ceremony, that these Seven Sisters came to the earth to explore the human way, and particularly the way of men. And the youngest, most naive sister formed a bond with a man who she discovered not long after, when she decided that it was time to leave, that she had a spell cast upon her. And she calls out for her sisters, and they come and rescue her. And in their fear and panic of being captured by this man, they flee to the stars and they form their star constellation, Pleiades.
It's amazing that there's a spot for women here, because there is a place for men at this festival too, isn't there?
There is. There are many men that have been involved in putting up the structures, getting out the chainsaw, chopping firewood, making little stacks, building the fire that became part of the ceremony, all behind the scenes. There's also a little camp of men down the road. They're around, and we acknowledge that healing the sacred feminine also means healing the divine masculine, because without the union of the two, we can't be whole.
So we've run into Catherine today. Now, Catherine is a blood witch, also known as a menstrual educator. Catherine, can you tell me what a blood witch does?
I guess blood witch is who I am. Menstrual education is how I deliver that to the world. I've been walking a conscious menstrual path, I guess, for 15 years. I learnt and taught myself how to be with the menstrual experience in a powerful and wise way, rather than most of our culture, which has it as a fairly shameful and painful place. Witch is a beautiful word. It means, for me, it just means I have no translator, I have no religion. Mm-hmm. I am my own conduit and have a relationship with spirit in the way I choose it to be. I also use witch because I believe ritual is a very big part of humanity. I think we've used ritual throughout the eons to create change in our lives. And ritual is a big part of the way I teach. And I teach transformative education or cultural education.
So I don't know much about what your philosophy is, but is it based along the idea that having a period is a beautiful and blessed thing, mm-hmm. rather than a painful thing?
It's recognising the menstrual experience is a gift. It's not a curse. It was never meant to be a curse. We're not born with shame, we learn shame. Yeah. The system is not designed to be painful. Yeah, it's actually designed to be ecstatic. And it's also designed to assist us with our emotional and mental health.
If you're feeling hungry, then Kelly's the person that you want to talk to. Kelly is the kitchen coordinator here at the Seven Sisters Festival. Kelly, what kinds of food is everyone dining on here?
Well, what we're doing, it's actually a communal kitchen. So what the sisters have done is everybody's brought along something to share. So we've had a big fridge full of things that people have donated, whether it be from their garden or they've just brought along because they thought they wanted to share, whatever they're inspired by. amazing things come out of that kitchen. Yeah, and just everybody coming together and doing it, working together. Share, create, collaborate. That's the aim of the game.
Very nice. Vegetarian foods?
Yeah, it's mostly been vegetarian. Mm-hmm. Vegan, mostly. There's some vegans around who just have honey. But yeah, it's mostly been vegan. Maybe a little bit of honey here and there.
Okay. So do you believe that food, like that movie, like Order for Chocolate, your energy and your spirit can go into the food while you're cooking it?
Oh, absolutely. Yeah, yeah, yeah. I mean, the secret ingredient in anything that tastes good is always love. It's, yeah. And there's so much love flowing in that kitchen.
We've just stumbled into the gorgeous fairy-like creature, Jaquila. And Jaquila was involved as the host of the opening ceremony. So what did that involve, Jaquila?
That involved welcoming, introducing all of our amazing artists. We had a program of very powerful women that nourished and empowered and really invigorated the group.
And Jaquila, you've travelled all the way down from Sydney to attend this event. Is it a big difference from your daily life in Sydney to the outback of Victoria?
I mean, I personally feel super blessed to have super sisters around me and to know what the sisterhood is all about. I feel so nourished, enriched. And so the sisterhood is always present in my life. And to experience it here on a larger scale, I mean, obviously this is a very different environment to Sydney City. And when you get an environment like this, rather than being in the city and feel like you have to protect yourself somewhat from all of this discordant energy, you can just relax and know that you can let go and do whatever you need to do to balance and feel whole within yourself. So, yeah, it's certainly a much more supportive environment for growth than we experience in the city.
Yeah.
Yeah, but I think it's very important to cultivate the sisterhood wherever you are.
Oh, thank you. Thanks, Jaquila. Mm.
We've had an incredible day out here in the bush, and we've learnt so much about what it is to be a woman. And we've spoken to some incredible people, from witches to specialists on menopause to people whose passion is food. I'm Amber, and this is Maha's Alternative Reality.
That's the end of the show. Hope you were satisfied. If you want to see or learn more, check out our Facebook or YouTube channel. And remember, let your freak flag fly!